welcome to Hack It Out. And as you can tell, this is going to be a little bit of a different episode. I mentioned before that one of the things we want to start doing is maybe some gameplay videos. So this is our first one. And I'm going to be playing through one of my favorite games, Banjo-Tooie. Now, this is the sequel to Banjo-Kazooie, and you might be wondering why I'm starting with this one first. And it's quite simple. This is my favorite one of the two. And I will play Banjo-Kazooie, but I want to play them in the order that I played them the first time, which I actually played the second one first, and then I played the first one. So I will be starting with Banjo-Tooie. All right. Now I should have a slot cleared here. Well, of course I don't, but we can fix that. Are you sure? Yes, I'm sure. I don't even know what that one was for. Just a little one. I was probably just going in and messing around. So I've got one here. This was almost a 90% one. Or almost 100% one. Actually, this was the one I played with my wife. I had her kind of go through the game, so we did this one together. This one over here was whenever I was trying a little speed run. Just getting like the bare minimum you need to be able to get to the basically to the final area. So that, I think that's my best time. I don't know, I might come on here again sometime and try a little speed run of it. But anyway, here's an empty one, so let's get going. Alright, I'll let this play out in case there's anybody watching this that has never played Banjo-Tooie before. A little opening credits, a little spoiler. Okay, here we go. 2 years have passed since Gruntilda the Witch was defeated by Banjo and Kazooie. So, 2 years since the ending of the first game. After falling from her tower, she was buried underground, where she remains until this very day. I'm not going to be doing good at doing voices through this. No good. Mistress still can't shift rock. Didn't do a good job with comma there. All because of that stupid bear. I probably could do different voices, but there's really no point. I mean, they all have their own. I might as well just let them speak in their own little gobbledygook they have. But then you guys might not want to read it. Might just want to hear me say it, so I guess I could just read it. I don't know. You'll have to let me know. I don't know how many people are going to be watching this, especially from the start, so you can let me know in the comments if you'd rather me read the text, or if you just want to read it yourself and listen to their speech. So, you know, everything is going good. They're all having fun playing games. Been a couple years. All's right with the world. Grunty was defeated at the end of the first game. You know. But, as usual, all good things must come to an end. For a little while, at least. Gotta have a second game. I'm also going through this one again because Yooka-Laylee's coming up, so, you know, gotta get into that collect-a-thon 3D platforming spirit. For those of you who don't know, haven't listened to me ramble about it in any of our podcasts and stuff, Yooka-Laylee is made by, it's made by Playtonic Games, which is a company that was formed from a lot of the guys who made these games, like the Banjo-Kazooie series, Donkey Kong Country, pretty much all the guys from like the glory days of Rare. They all kind of got together and formed Playtonic a couple of years ago. I think they just celebrated their second anniversary. And Yooka-Laylee is going to be their first game. So really, it's a spiritual successor to the Banjo-Kazooie series, because after this game, they never really got to make the Banjo-3E that they wanted to make. Rare was sold to Microsoft, and then Microsoft kind of wanted to take it in an unfortunate direction via Banjo-Kazooie Nuts and Bolts, which is not a bad game. It's just not Banjo. It's not what everybody wanted. One of Grunty's sisters. It's kind of funny, a little bit of a cliche. She's got like a tall, skinny sister and then a short, fat sister. Kind of represent everything with these witches. Never even noticed before you could see Blumbelda's underpants there. That's nice. I usually just skip these opening scenes because I've, you know, seen them a lot whenever I was younger, and usually whenever I play this, I'm just, I don't know, there's no point to go through this. I guess I could have introduced some of these characters. So obviously there's Banjo, Kazooie's the bird in his backpack. The guy with glasses they're playing with is Bottles. His role in the first game was he's the one that kind of taught you some of the moves. And this guy, Mumbo Jumbo, he's a shaman, so he did like some transformations in the first game. You would pay him some Mumbo tokens, and in whatever world he was in, he would transform you to some sort of thing that would go along with that world. Like the first world transformed you into a termite, which you needed to be for, you know, a couple areas of the world. Unfortunately, he's not in every world though in Banjo-Kazooie. He's only a few worlds that he transformed you in. I believe, let's see, 1, 2, 3, 4. I'm trying to think. I know he's in the first world, Mumbo's Mountain. Transforms you into a termite. And then in Bubble Gloop Swamp, he transforms you into an alligator. Mad Monster Mansion, he transforms you into a pumpkin. And Click Clock Wood, you get transformed into a bumblebee? Yeah, I think just those four. I don't know, might be missing one. Surely there's more than that, but... oh, yeah, there is. In Freeze Easy Peak, you turn into a little walrus. And I think that's it. I'm sure if I missed one, you know, anybody who's played this game can let me know in the comments, but I'm pretty sure that's it. He's got a little bit of a different role in this game, though. He doesn't transform you. Alright, so Grunty's back. She's just bones. She's been rotting away under the ground for 2 years, so just bones and clothes. However you think that works. But she's a witch, and her sisters are witches, so I guess anything's possible. Plus, it's a video game. That's nice that she still has her magic. After being dead for 2 years, she's still got it. Well, kind of. She's kind of missing him. Man, this opening scene is, you know, a lot longer than I thought it was. But we're this far in, might as well let you guys finish seeing it. I'm trying to decide if I want to do this as a 100% playthrough. That'll be really difficult for me. Probably difficult for those of you to watch, too. Yeah, I don't know. I might not do 100%. I might just do... I don't know. Because there's some... the main collectible in this game is a little jigsaw puzzle piece called a Jiggy. And there's like 10 in each world. 10 to get. And there's some Jiggies in this game that are... Man, they're really difficult, and I am known for not having a lot of patience, so there's a few that I'm not sure if I'd be able to get. I mean, I'm sure I could if I tried and tried and tried, but, I mean, we could probably spend like a couple of 30-minute episodes on just me trying to get one Jiggy, and, I mean, it might be entertaining for you guys, because I'd probably be getting really ticked off and really angry the whole time, but, yeah, I don't know. I don't know what I'm gonna do. I guess we'll just see once I start playing. see what I feel like doing. And I mean, this is just my first little episode. I can pretty much 100% the first world, no problems. I mean, a couple of the jiggies are annoying, but I can do them. So I guess we'll see how long it takes me to do that one, and then I don't know how many episodes that'll be. I don't think I could do it in one, because I don't want these to be like hour-long segments, maybe like 30 minutes. If that, I might do 20 minutes, I don't know. Some people like to sit through long videos, some people don't. I know, you know, people like Game Grumps, they do, like 10 to 15 minutes, sometimes a little bit longer than that, which is a good time frame, but I mean, I'm not trying to mimic Game Grumps in any way. So I don't know. And then there's some people who do walkthroughs and, you know, Let's Plays that are, you know, they might have 30 minute to an hour long segments, so I guess I'll just go for a little while, see how it turns out. If it feels like it's too long, then, you know, whatever. It's just the first one. Yes, if you know, any of you watch this, you can let me know if you prefer the longer ones or the shorter ones, and we'll just kind of go from there. But until then, I'll probably just stick to around 30 minutes or whatever. Depends on once I start getting to the parts that really frustrate me and tick me off. Those I might quit earlier. I don't know. Alright, so I was pretty much rambling through all of that, but if you were actually watching this and not listening to me, then you see the Bottles just got killed. So now he's a ghost. And Banjo's house kind of got destroyed a little bit too. Not to mention Spiral Mountain kind of got a little bit wrecked. And the laugh of Grunty. Alright, so the game starts. Yeah. It's gotta be weird to be able to see your body like that. Okay. So he wants me to remind him, or wants to remind me of my original moves, like from the first game, but I don't really need to be reminded. I pretty much know them. And then the fish, Royston, is stuck underneath that boulder, but I can't get rid of that boulder yet. Don't have the move that'll do that. Don't learn that until World 2. Glitter Gulch Mine. Glitter Gulch Mine. That's it. Not Glitter Gulch Mine. Said it too close together. Alright, so Klungo's over there harassing me. But I'll get to him in just a second. I'll walk around Spiral Mountain for a little bit. You know, it's funny, any of you who have played Banjo-Kazooie, you know, Spiral Mountain, it's the same music, but in Spiral Mountain, in the first game, it's all, you know, happy and cheerful, really upbeat, and this one is just so melancholy. Alright. Kinda like to cheat, I always use this Talentrot, it's a move you learned in the first game. It's just walk around a heck of a lot faster. So, pick up some eggs, which is your ammo for this game. You get different kinds of eggs throughout the game, different ones that do different things. Shock spring pad. Of course, you know, I play this with it being recorded. And of course I'm gonna probably do some stupid things. Here's Cheeto Page. So that's the inside of Grunty's Lair, which was like the stage for the whole game. It was like the hub world in the first game. So now it's all in ruins and caved in, you can't really go anywhere. So what I just got was a Cheeto Page. And you know, every 5 of those you collect, you go to Cheeto and he will give you like a little cheat that you can use if you want. I believe it's every 5. I don't know. That's something that I usually don't mess with. But yeah, in the first game, you're kind of going through here. I mean, obviously, there's no destruction. You're going through here, and you got to get, like, pieces of empty honeycomb pieces, and it'll, like, refill your or not refill, it'll add a piece to your life bar, but there's really no point in me doing walking around here, really. I was just kind of showing you the place. It's called Spiral Mountain because, well, yeah, you can't really see it from that up close, but the thing in the middle is a mountain that kind of goes up in a spiral shape, so hence the name. Kill those little guys. Okay, so now this hole that's been created, this is what'll take you to the hub world of this game. But along the way, I'll fight this little jerk that was harassing me, Klungo. First boss fight of the game. You actually fight him 3 times throughout the game. He's really easy. But there's 3 different potions that he can drink that do different things. And then I'm playing the Xbox 360 version of this. The Nintendo 64 version, it was random, like which one he would take first. Well, which one he would take any of the times. I don't think he would have a repeat one, but it was just, you know, the order was completely random in which you get the potions. But on this one, for some reason, they took the randomization out of it. So the first one is always the enlarge one. I was close. I was sitting there talking. I almost let him stomp on me. Would have been like the first time I've ever been hit by him in this first fight. So he gets big, you hit him, and then he tries to throw potions at you. You just gotta dodge him. Like I said, it was a really easy boss fight. First one in the game, though, you kind of expect it. Hit 3 times and he's done. That's what you get for harassing me. Alright, now he's gonna talk about running back to Grunty. She's gonna beat him or something like that. It's just kind of her little minion. I think he was kind of probably inspired by like Igor from Frankenstein. Please, he wants her to beat him with the broomstick. I guess that's a loyal worker you've got if he knows that he messed up and wants you to punish him. Good grief. Alright. All these tire tracks that the witches had to leave when they kind of bulldozed their way through here. So Isle of Hags, this is the hub world of this game. I mean, it's huge. So huge it's got these little silos that actually transport you between different areas. There's like a different area of Isle of Hags right next to each world entrance. But I guess not in front of everyone, because some of them are doubled up. Like there's a couple areas that there's actually a couple of worlds that you can access from there. So yeah, look what those jerks did in their destruction. They bulldozed over the gray Jinjo house and just killed them. So these are all the Jinjo houses, and the Jinjos, they're these little like helpless creatures in this village that they're pretty much scattered throughout the game, and you gotta collect them, find them, like rescue them. In the first game, there was 5 in each world. It was just like a set, 5 in each world. Like they're all, you know, each world had a blue, a green, a yellow, a pinkish purple one, and then a orange, I believe. Is that the right colors? Something like that. Anyways, the same 5 in each world. Whereas this, they kind of changed it to Jinjo families. So you got, you know, family of reds, of greens, of oranges, whites, and each color, there's a different number of them. So like the white family, there's only 1 Jinjo. The yellow, there's only 2. And it goes all the way up to the black Jinjo family. There's 9 of them. And then you get a Jiggy once you've completed the whole family. So, and this is where the king lives, the king of the Jinjos. King Jingling. this little pet that I have no idea what kind of creature this thing is. King of all things, Jinjo, and ruler of this village. Kickball tournament. Priorities. Rivalry between the Jinjos and the moles. Which is funny because I only see one family of moles in this game. It's Bottles family. First Jiggy. Yeah, like Bottles and his wife, and they've got two kids, I believe, and then his brother. I don't know of any other moles, but I guess there's more. So it's pretty much just setting up the stage, like telling you where you're gonna have to go, how you're gonna go there. So there's this guy, Master Jiggy Wiggy. You gotta go to his temple, and he's the one that pretty much opens up the world. So when you collect enough Jiggies to open up a world, when you fill that requirement, then you go to Jiggy Wiggy's temple and do like a little puzzle thing, and then he'll open up the world. So another cutscene. That pet's name is Toots. Well, I guess you can either pronounce it Toots or Toots. T-O-O-T-S. However you want to pronounce it. It's not like you get a pronunciation from them because they speak gibberish. So this is where you go into the game. This is where you're getting to Cauldron Keep. It's where the weapon is. It's where all the witches are. The final battle takes place up on top of that tower. The BOB control. Blow or suck. Only two options. Not a complicated machine if you only got two buttons. Big old blaster. So yeah, I guess the object of the game is they're using that machine to basically like suck all the life force out of the land and basically restore Grunty to, you know, full health, like basically bring her completely back to life instead of just being a walking bones and clothes. But obviously can't let that happen, so man, these cutscenes really do take a lot longer than I remembered. Like I said, I never sit through them anymore. Anyway, so who is the first target? Well, I know who it is, but don't want to spoil it. You got about probably 5 seconds to figure out who it is. Yeah, King Jingling. It's kind of neat though, because you'll see like the color slowly start to fade out of his temple. I believe it even starts like, I think it starts from the bottom and goes up. Or it goes from the top down. Yeah, from the top down. Pretty neat. Ah, it just looks like a stone monument. It's all gray and lifeless. And now he's zombified. And then I couldn't even figure out whatever happened to Toots. Like, I mean, it's just like a pair of eyes on that couch, but I don't know if it's like hiding in the cushion of that little couch thing, or if it just got blown to dust, and all that's left is eyes. I don't know. So this first video, I guess, might be a little bit longer than 30 minutes since I haven't actually gotten to the first world yet. Classic villains, you know, they think they're unstoppable and they're not gonna be able to stop us. We got rid of his friends, blah blah blah. Alright, well, I am not gonna go through there. That's how you're supposed to go, is through Bottle's house, and there's like a little pathway through one of his kids' rooms that'll take you to where you need to go, Jiggy Wiggy's temple. But I like to do this little shortcut, which you watch. I'm not gonna be able to do it now since I'm recording this. If I can even remember how to do it. Of course, I'm not gonna be able to do it. So basically, you can get on top of this because there's a move, you know, to grip the ledge. But naturally, you don't get that move to start off with. They didn't even have that move in the first game, which, I mean, it's kind of dumb that they didn't, but they didn't really need it, I guess. But yeah, so you kind of have to do this. This little trick that you can get up there. I'm going to give this a few more tries, and if I can't do it, I'm not going to waste everybody's time here. But I used to be able to do this thing, like, flawlessly. But, like I said, it's because I'm recording. So now everybody gets to watch me fail at this thing. Oh, gosh. Come on. There we go. Okay. Whew. So anyway, that's a little trick. For any of you watching who didn't know that you could do that, now you know. You are welcome. It's really not hard to do. It just takes some practice. Okay, so this is the first, you know, I was talking about how this overworld, or this hub world, Isle of Hags, how there's different sections in front of each world entrance. Well, this is the first section. And this, because that right there is the entrance to the first world, Mayhem Temple. And so now that I've activated this silo, and I can travel between the two. The first one was in Jinjo Village, but no need for me to go back there right now, so. That's where you go to deposit your jiggies, I guess you could say. So see there on the left, it tells you how many are required to open up the next world, and on the right is how many you have. So obviously we meet the requirement to open the first world, but before I go in there, there's a Jiggy, or a Jinjo, that's always in this tunnel, and every time, it's always a black one. Wow. It's actually not. I'm telling you, like, the last, I feel like the last five times I've played this, it's always been a black one down there. I was beginning to wonder if that was even randomized anymore. Because some things that were supposed to be random aren't. Like what I was talking about earlier with Klungo. Jinjos are one thing that's, I mean, it's random, where, what color and where each Jinjo is. Well, not the placement. Jinjos are always in the same places, but the colors are random. So yeah, whenever you touch them, I mean, they don't move around, so they're just standing there helpless, because I guess they can't do anything. Just waiting for you to grab them, and then they zoom off home. I don't know why they can't zoom off home first. It's like they've got some sort of magical lock on them or something. I don't know. That's just me overanalyzing it. But anyway, so then they zoom off home. But, yeah, I was beginning to wonder if that one down there was not random, and if it was always a black one, but apparently not. I've just always gotten that one. And yes, this thing's head is a Jiggy, and it's odd. This is the disciple of Master Jiggy Wiggy. Telling you about the Jiggies. They say it seems familiar. Well, yeah, it seems familiar because that's what you collected in the first game. McJiggies. Gosh. Only food purchased at McJiggies can be eaten inside. But there is no McJiggy's in the game. I don't know where that place is. And there's Jiggy Wiggy himself. Sacred Temple. You know, where was this place at in the first game? I mean, obviously this place was here, but the first game you collected Jiggies, you never had to bring them to them. The Jiggies just had the powers themselves. So anyway, this is like a little game you gotta do. It's just a little, I mean, it's a little puzzle. It's very fitting for the Jiggies. So you're this big, slightly invisible hand of Banjo's. You pick the pieces up and complete the puzzle. And yeah, it's super easy here at the beginning, but obviously with each world that you are opening up, it does indeed get harder. Like more pieces are missing from the picture. Because like by the end, like one of the last ones you put together, actually I think the last one you do put together is completely empty. I don't think there's any pieces on the board. Alright, so now he's going to use his magic to open up the world. Gosh, I was hoping I would actually play some of the first world, but I don't know. We're getting close to that 30-minute mark. I really don't want the first one to be a super long video. So I guess this just could be the intro video, and then the next one will actually be when we start diving into the game itself. So Wooded Hollow. Each section of Isle of Hags has a name, and this one is Wooded Hollow. Because like whenever you jump in the silo to travel back and forth between the different areas, and you know which area it is. So Wooded Hollow is the one to go to whenever you need to open up the other worlds, or if you ever need to, you know, go back to Mayhem Temple, which is the first world. So as you can see, now it shows 4 is required to open the next world, and I've only got 1, so can't do anything. Anyway, all these go inside Mayhem Temple. Alright, so this is the first world, Mayhem Temple. It's a really good one. I don't think it's my favorite world of the game, but it's definitely up there. And these worlds are much larger than the worlds in Banjo-Kazooie. So large, in fact, that there's these warp pads placed throughout the world. There's several of them, so you can warp to different parts of the world, which helps. Otherwise, it would take quite a while to traverse between certain sections, but, you know, I've only got this first one unlocked. I gotta activate another warp pad, obviously, to be able to go to that one. But anyway, I guess that's where I will stop this video now that we're in Mayhem Temple. So I hope you guys enjoy this. You know, this is our first one. Any of the things that I've said through here, you know, whether you'd prefer me to actually read the texts or, you know, do voices or whatever, or if you just want me to leave it as is so that you can read it yourself and listen to them speak it during like the dialogue, then just let me know what you want me to do down in the comments. And also lengthwise, is this a good length, like 30 minutes? I know this one was mostly filled with cutscenes, but just let me know if you want them to be quicker videos or longer videos, whatever your preference is. So I am flexible. But anyway, we will start Mayhem Temple in the next one. All right. Thank you guys for watching. We'll see you next time.